Thank my lucky stars to be living here today. 'Cause the flag still stands for freedom, and I can't take that away. And I'm proud to be American, where at least I know I'm free. And I won't forget the men who died, who gave that right to me. And I gladly stand up next to you and defend her still today. 'Cause there ain't no doubt from the lakes of Minnesota to the hills of Tennessee, across the plains of Texas, from sea to shining sea, from Detroit down to Houston and New York to LA, where there's pride in every American heart, and it's time we stand and say,
you'll join me in invitation tonight. Heavenly Father, we come with mixed feelings tonight. Our hearts are heavy based on the tragedy our fellow citizens encountered in Allen recently at the Allen Mall. We pray for those families that are hurting. We pray for those who were there and observed what went on. It was horrendous. And we only know that your grace is sufficient to cover everything that they need. And we pray that you would pour it out abundantly on those families. Father, I do thank you for the police officers and the sheriffs and the constables who all responded to that event. Thank you for their rapid response, especially the Allen police officer who did his duty. We thank you for him, and thank you that he was in the line of fire and took action that needed to be taken. We thank you for his training. We thank you for his well-being, and we pray that he will be undergirded as well. Now tonight, Lord, we want to ask you to bless our food, bless our fellowship. We thank you for bringing us here tonight, and thank you for the rain we've had. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Amen.
Now the national anthem. salute the flag.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
And now the Texas flag.
Under the Texas flag, I pledge allegiance to thee, Texas, one state under God, one and indivisible.
Be seated. Of the Republican Club here at Heritage Ranch, I wish to extend warm welcomes to all of our neighbors, all of our friends, and all of our office holders that are here tonight. We love having you here. We think we got a great program for you. So thanks again for your full attendance that we have here again tonight. So a few things that we need to cover. Some of you probably get tired of hearing me say this, but we have several new members here tonight that need to know this. On the back of your name badge, there is a meal ticket card. So our waiters know what meals to bring to what table, but they don't know whether you're having fish or beef tonight, unless you put that little tag behind your plate. So please do that, and that'll allow all of our waiters to do a good job for you, which they want to do. Secondly, another item that we want to present is that tonight, we always listen to our members. I say that all the time, but we do. So you asked for a improvement in the meals, and we've worked very closely with the HOA here. So tonight we have the premium salmon and the premium beef plate. So I hope you enjoy it. Now, to keep the price the same, we had to remove the salad to pay for the extra meal. If we were Democrats, we would just charge everybody extra. That's where we are on that issue. Another couple of issues that our members have brought up to me, I've had some of our members asked me, one in particular today, if we couldn't have some meetings during the month with our legislative team so we could discuss critical issues that you all see every day in the news and all the different reporting going on. And some of you are interested in carrying those issues further, and you want to see our club do more, and you'd like to sit in kind of a round table discussion to do that. So guess what? That's what you want us to do. That's what we'll do. So that will begin. I should have mentioned on the meal, tomorrow morning, if you look at our website tomorrow morning, you'll see a survey. Those surveys, we pay a lot of attention to those surveys. So if you ever want to make sure that your viewpoint is heard, fill out the survey. But the survey is going to ask you what you think of this meal tonight, whether you'd like to see us do more of this kind of thing, or do you just want to go back to the regular meal that we had. So tomorrow morning, when you get up and you have that cup of coffee, check our website, and please fill out that survey so we know what you, our beloved members, want us to do. Now, I'd like to give our legislative chairman, Ben Brown, an opportunity to cover for you the results of the election that we just held here. So, Ben?
Okay, don't pay attention because this is going to be fast. I have 3 minutes. Here we go. Who won? In precinct 179, in the Lovejoy trustee race, Mark Wheelis won with 55% of the vote. Over Amy Gamble, we got 45% of the vote. So that's who won. Next slide, please. Who did not win? The airport did not win. And it was substantial. Almost 59% against the airport. Next slide, please. Who else did not win? Fred Moses did not win. And I'm going to spend some time on this slide. Fred, these are unofficial results, by the way. The College Board of Trustees meets tomorrow to canvass the votes, so they won't be official until tomorrow. Also, the provisional ballots have not been counted at this time. So, Fred lost by 86 votes across the county. I want you to notice this bottom line down here, undervotes. What is an undervote? Somebody went to the poll, voted in another election, and didn't vote in this election. 17,000 folks did not vote in this election. We shake our head. In precinct 179, our precinct, we had 197 undervotes. If our precinct had voted in favor of Fred, he would have won the election. If those undervotes had been counted. So don't point fingers at the rest of the county. And I'm sure most of y'all voted. But I've got some more to tell you in just a minute. Those undervotes were critical. Next slide, please. Who has not won yet? Jay Sod has not won yet. Jay came in second to a Democrat. There were 19,953 undervotes in that election. And 226 from precinct 179. But again, there were enough undervotes. If most of it voted for Jay, we would have won. He would have won. The good news is, on June 10th, there's a runoff between Jay and his opponent, Scott Coleman. Next slide, please. Who's not won yet? Kathy Alexander. She's going to come out in a minute and tell you to vote for herself. I'm going to tell you to vote for herself. She came in second. Again, 19,000 plus undervotes. And when you look across the county and see all these undervotes, who are those people? I bet you 70% of them were Republicans. So we've got to get the message out in the June 10th election. No undervotes. That'll be easy. There's going to be two races on the ballot. You shouldn't skip either one of them and vote for Kathy and vote for Jay. Next slide, please. Well, how did we do? How did precinct 179 do in this whole scheme of things? Precinct 179 is the 22nd largest precinct in the county in terms of registered voters. We were number 5 in the total votes cast in the county. So that's pretty good. Heritage Ranch alone turned in 629 votes. So we did good. We could have done better. If you look at the largest precincts in the county, precinct 179 came in 4th, 21.75% turnout. Heritage Ranch with almost 33% turnout. But folks, when we vote 88 or 90% in a regular election, 32% is not acceptable. So I know everybody in this room voted, but you need to get all your friends to go vote on June 10th. The next slide, please. June 10th, runoff election, that's a Saturday. As of a day or so ago, the times were not published and the locations were not published. They may have been today, I didn't check them. But check our website, go to our website, go to the May 6th election, and you will see a place for the locations and the times. So I encourage all of you to go vote on June 10th for Jay Sod and Kathy Alexander. We do not need another Democrat on the Collin County, Collin College Board of Trustees. I've had several people ask me the question, how did Stacy Donald come in first in that race? Undervotes and turnout's the issue. The second question I get is, how was she elected 6 years ago? In the county race, about 22% of the total vote was undervotes this time. 6 years ago, it was 30%. So that's exactly how Donald got elected 6 years ago. The undervotes and folks not turning out and voting, we don't need that to happen again. So June 10th, very important day. I hope you put it on your calendar and show up bright and early to vote. And there'll be more information on the website. So now, I'll turn it back over to Jack.
Thank you. Just in case you don't know, Stacy Donald, the Democrat, is the one who turns her back to the flag when they say the Pledge of Allegiance at their meetings. Now, if that doesn't upset every single person in this room, I don't know what else I can say that does. So we all need to go vote on June the 10th and make certain that that kind of attitude and that kind of display, flagrant display of unpatriotism towards our country does not preside over our Collin County schools. Okay, now you get to meet your elected officials. So here we go. First one. Oh my goodness. You're an elected official? Okay.
I'm an unelected official. I'm Ron Samuels. I've been asked to speak a few words for Mark Wheelis, who is down in Georgetown with his wife, Gayla, and their daughter. They're playing in the state golf tournament with the Lovejoy Golf Club. So Mark wanted to thank everybody that helped him, and he wants to thank everybody that went to vote. And he encourages everybody to go vote again. So appreciate it. And you don't have to vote the last time, but go vote this time.
And just for the record, we would like to see you as an elected official.
I am Abraham George. I serve as your county chair. One thing I want to say is there's nothing else on the ballot in June 10th. So it's just two people, and I think it's going to be a lot worse than what we had, because if it's Collin College trustees, most people in the county does not know what's happening. So please, this precinct, if you guys show up, I think we'll make all the difference. And you do show up in every election. So Kathy Alexander, Jay Sad is the only two things we need to worry about. Only two people we need to worry about in the next few days. We can start our infight afterwards. So let's come together and get them elected. Thank you.
Hi, good evening, everybody. My name is Judge Brooke Folks. I was honored to be appointed by Governor Greg Abbott to be judge of the 470th District Court here in Collin County. My official investiture is Friday at 2 p.m. at the Collin County Courthouse. Everyone is invited. You don't have to RSVP. We'd love to see you on Friday at 2. Judge Brooke Folks, thank you.
Good afternoon. My name is Sammy Knapp. I'm Constable Precinct 3. I want to take a minute to tell you, 46 years in law enforcement, I've never been so proud of the officers that all responded Saturday. I'm very proud.
Ladies and gentlemen, I'm Matt Carpenter, and I'm honored to serve as your constable right here in Precinct 1. Casey and I are blessed to be back with you tonight. We look forward to it every month. And remember, my seat was a two-year seat, which means, thankfully, I get to file again in November, so I'll need all your support then, too. Thank y'all very much.
Good evening. My name is Dwayne Kurtz, and I'm running for candidate for Precinct 2 Constable's office here in Collin County. Thank you.
Hello, everyone. My name is Rich Connolly. I'm on Fairview Council seat 1, and I just want to have a question. I have a question for you. Is everyone as happy as I am that the McKinney Airport bond?
There's a man who knows how to get a cheap round of applause right there. Hi, I'm Ken Logston. I live in Heritage Ranch, and I'm proud to represent you on the Fairview Town Council. Thank you.
Good evening, friends. I'm Chris Hill. It's my pleasure to serve as your Collin County judge.
Hi, I'm Jim Pickle. I'm happy to serve you guys on as SDH committee man on the state Republican Executive Committee, and they slotted me between two superstars, so I expect applause. Thank you.
Good evening. My name is Randy Johnson. It is my honor to serve you as judge of Collin County Court of Law Number 5. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Maggie Witt. I am your SREC for SD8. Just so you know, I've been to Austin about 10 or 12 times so far, and I was there when they passed SB14. That was amazing. And I'm starting block walking tomorrow to make sure that enough Republicans turn out to make sure these guys get elected. Thank you.
Tired is tired, so I'm going to use notes. I'm sorry. First off, I want to thank you guys so much for coming out in the numbers that you did. This was a stronghold for three of us, and we are so proud to have you at our corner. It's beyond words. And I think that we've already been told. Talked to Fred as we were driving here today, and he said that they've given him hope, that they're looking at the military and the cured ballots. If he can get about a 90 or 100 votes, then he'll pull ahead of his contender, his opponent, and maybe we'll get Fred back on the board. Just pray, 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 folks, pray. You know, the Republican women have a saying, when women work, we win. So I am asking for you to go on to my website, Kathy, C-A-T-H-I-E, for Collin.com. There's a How Can I Help button. Get on there and put your name and put tree. And let me tell you why. We are going to do an old-fashioned phone tree, just like we did when we didn't have email and text and all that. You're going to pick 10 of your friends that you'll make sure will get to the polls and vote. They're going to pick 10 of their friends to be sure to follow. And then Dave Stoner, who is a whiz bang at data collection, will let us know after early voting has started who has voted and who has not. So who you can praise, thank you so much for voting for this time around, and who needs to come out and vote. So if you would please get on my website, Kathy for Collin, .com, and donate your 10 names of friends. All you need to do is say tree on there, and I'll be back in contact with you. Something else I was supposed to say. We have an opportunity to match funds with the GOP. So we are looking desperately for deep pockets, little pockets, big pockets, any kind of pockets. We are really wanting to, I was flabbergasted. They said this is going to be an $80,000 runoff period. That's 30 days, and it's going to cost us $80,000. And I laughed because I said, we don't get paid for this, folks. What are we doing spending $80,000? But we are, what we're doing is keeping the board from turning in a direction that may not fit the complexion of the people that live in Collin County. We really want to keep the board conservative and moving in a direction that is pro low taxes, low tuition, high success. So we need your help. We need prayer and donations. We need them now. You guys, we're told early election starts on May 30th. If you'll go to my website, Lisa Babb, who helps with the elections in McKinney, has put on my website where you just look on there and you can find the closest polling location to Heritage Ranch. So please visit us, and I'm going to let Jay talk now.
Thank you. I appreciate it. Jay Sad, place two. I'm lucky to be in this runoff. We got beat at the polls, and I'm taking as much blame as anybody else out there. I'm taking more blame. So trust me, I'm coming out punching, and I'm ready to go. Something that we need to know about, and I'm not going to ask anybody to raise hands, anybody over the age 65 is going to get a tax break next year from Collin College, because Fred and I pushed that through, and we got it done. Now, they're not going to tell you that until the vote's over, but it's going to save $8.2 million. So one of our biggest responsibilities is for you all. We're supposed to be your fiduciaries, and we're going to save $8.2 million for anybody who's over the age 65 or disabled. That's one of the savings. Kathy also mentioned, I wish I had it. So, but the other part of it too is Kathy mentioned, we're the second lowest tax rate in the state of Texas, and now we're going to even go deeper on that. So we're going deeper on that. Tuition for our students, $62 an hour. If you wanted to go to the University of North Texas, it's $200 an hour. Guess what? If you have a high school student or a grandkid that's going to high school and they go and get dual credits, they can get dual credits. We have 9,000 dual credit students right now at Collin College paying the lowest tuition in the state of Texas, and they get credit for any courses they take. So again, we need to go after. Everybody look around here. You guys can make a change. You bring a few friends, we can definitely make a change. So again, we got beat last time. We're not getting beat again. Jay Sad, Kathy Alexander, we are not done.
So I know it's hard for you to believe, but I'm one of the people that's going to get a piece of the $8.2 million rebate. So, good news. All right, so I know you want to eat, and we're just about there. We're going to talk about future events, though, so you can talk about this at your table while you're eating dinner tonight. So, on June the 19th, we are having Trevor Loudon, who resides in Florida, coming all the way up here to talk to us. And Debbie, I always have trouble saying this, but I think it's Georgiotis. She will be with him. She has a show every day at 3:00, and her show is America Can We Talk? So we'll have the two of them here on stage. Trevor has a lot to say about the influence of socialism and communism in our country and office holders in Washington that support that line of thinking. So I think it'll be a great meeting for you to see. I think you'll be pretty worked up after you hear the presentation. Secondly, National Defense Safety Briefing. That'll be Sunday, June the 11th at 4:30, right here in this ballroom. Ted, who handles that for us, assures me that we have an outstanding program lined up. Please check the website for the information. And finally, Collin County GOP Golf Tournament. We're telling you early so that we get everybody participating. It's going to be right here at Heritage Ranch, September the 15th. So I understand that Abraham George is going to be there to hit the ball off the first tee for us. Is that right, Abraham?
Yeah.
All right. Another thing that you talk to us about often is, and I hear this message a lot, and that is, you know, we do, we work hard to get the message to you, the information to you that we think is important in this time. And a lot of you have said, but I want my grandkids to hear some of this. I don't like the message that they're getting in the schools, and I'd like for the Republican Club here at Heritage Ranch to help provide the right information. So we happen to have a key member of our club who is really good at this research work and on this particular subject. And we are going to have a program this summer, and I've asked Greg Butler to come out here and tell you all about it. So, Greg.
I really appreciate this opportunity. I know many of you in the audience, and I know you are very patriotic, and it's great to come here and feel this. Many of you have served your country, you've put yourselves in harm's way, you've sworn oaths to defend this country from enemies, foreign and domestic, and that is no small feat. I don't know about you, but I turn the TV on and I hear things they don't make sense. And I just sit here and I go, why? With people trying to get off, you know, leaky boats and swim rivers and do dangerous things to get here, it is clear that our country is exceptional and we are the best hope on the planet for people. And I believe that to my core. But why? What is it that makes our opponents, liberalism, so-called progressives, hate this country so bad? I'm going to share a little of this with you, because when you sit there and think about it, why do they have to tear down the Constitution? Why do they have to discredit the Founding Fathers? Why are they pillaging all the different institutions? And it's because it is the only thing that's in their way. When you read the documents called, the Federalist Papers, you realize that the Founding Fathers were thinking about something beyond just building a country. They had a greater vision. And the last thing they wanted to do is replace a tyrant with another tyrant, and it didn't matter whether it was a tyrant of the majority or a tyrant of one, it's still a tyrant. And so when you come back, you know, we think a lot of this stuff is new, and we're gonna have a program on this whole issue of communism and socialism, but let me tell you, it's not something new, not something new at all. How many of you have heard of a guy called Woodrow Wilson, 28th president? Have you? Well, number one, he started as a professor, then he went on to become a politician, and then he governor of New Jersey, and then he never had a real job. Interesting. Never had a real job. But I'm going to read you one of his quotes. He's giving a speech to honor Thomas Jefferson, supposedly. And here's what he has to say about the Declaration of Independence. And I'll read it directly to you. Well, if you really want to understand the Declaration of Independence, don't repeat the preface. And he goes on to say it's really just a list of complaints. And so if y'all would pull out your pocket constitutions, I want to give special thanks. I left mine at home. Tom gave me his, because he carries it wherever he goes. Tom, thank you so much. You really helped. Well, what is it that Woodrow Wilson told you to forget? We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal, and they are endowed by their Creator with certain unalienable rights. Among these are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. That to secure these rights, governments are instituted among men, deriving their just powers from the consent of the governed, that whatever form of government becomes destructive of these ends, it is the right of the people to alter or abolish it and institute new government, laying the foundation on such principles. And it goes on, because what they were saying is not just for American citizens. This was an ideal for all men, that they were endowed with it. Well, they want us to forget this. This is part of discrediting the whole farm. He wrote all kinds of things about an all-powerful government. And the Constitution put that in the way. So if you want to know where income tax came from, he's your guy. If you want to know where all these big, the dark statist, or what we call the administrative state, where you have all these activists who go to Washington, get a job, write laws, that's where they come from. So that work was carried on by Theodore Roosevelt. It was carried on by a lot of politicians all the way up to today, and it's not getting any better. So wouldn't it be a shame if we're the last generation that understands this? How good a job have we done presenting this information to our children, and I'm talking about the big ones, more or less our grandkids? And so what we have put together is this. We have created or found a collection of materials. We've got 30 or 40 hours of high-level videos, a lot of it from Hillsdale. We're putting together a program, a two-hour session, in which we're going to explore the Federalist Papers. We're going to explore the Constitution. And we're going to match it up with things that are happening today. I can't pull my phone out without hearing a story and going, it's right here. This is the very thing that they put in this section of the Constitution so this wouldn't happen. And if we're not going to get fooled, if you want to know your enemy, you got to know how your enemy thinks. You've got to understand all this. And that's the idea here, is that we're going to put together a two-hour, very engaging, live interaction where we're going to get some information, and then we're going to have some real relevant things, things that are happening today. And if you want to be a part of that, we need to know that. We did the survey, but I'm going to be placing the sign-up sheets right outside. And we're looking at June to early July. Late June, early July is our time frame. But we need to get an idea of how many people want to participate. Now, the material is oriented to people that are probably ready in high school, getting in high school. Trust me, the public schools aren't teaching any of the stuff you're going to hear. In fact, they're teaching the opposite. But they're going to get more indoctrination when they go to college. At least give them a chance to hear the truth and have an interactive discussion. If you will let us know your name, your phone number, we'll get you on a list as this develops. But also tell us who you think you'd bring. I know a lot of you have older grandchildren in the area. You have adult children. We're going to make this a fun event. And I thank you for the opportunity.
Thank you, Greg. So I'm coming, and I'm going to bring my children and my grandchildren, because I think they need to hear the truth. So that's what we're going to present. Okay, you've been waiting for some time now for me to say these special words. It's time for dinner. So please begin serving the dinner. Thank you.
Besides the socialization, is to hear a very good speaker. Before I introduce him, I want to put in one more plug for Collin College. I have been in education all my working life. I know a good school. I know what they offer. And I 100% am in back of Collin College. 100%. They have done many things in the last years. They've expanded their campuses, built new campuses. I had the good fortune when I came here to attend some, education for the senior citizen, you know. And I became acquainted with them, but they have branched out so much. And I have family members currently that are there. But what I particularly like is the fact that they connect their college to the community, 100%, the business community. They are there to educate men, women, young and old, and help them to get a job, which is really what school is all about. So I urge you to vote and keep it going the way it has been with this fine Republican board. So please go out there and vote. And I think we need to put it on our website or send out messages when the early voting, I think there is early voting, am I right? So that everybody will vote. But now going to the evening, the program, I think as Republicans, we certainly have an important mission in the future. We are Republicans, as you heard from Ben, many times we take too much for granted and we just don't get out there and vote, right? I mean, we see it all the time. I think in this state, if all the Republicans voted, we wouldn't have a problem. But boy, oh boy, if we don't get out and vote, we're going to have a big problem. So tonight, we have the honor and privilege of having the chairman of our Republican Party of Texas to speak with you. And hopefully he can tell us the way it is and what we can do as a club, as individuals, to see that we have a killing in 2024 so that we can bring our country back to what we want it to be, which is far away from what it is right now. Yes. So I want to tell you a few things about our chairman, Matt Rinaldi. He represented Northwest Dallas County in the state legislature from 2015 to 2019. And during this time in office, Chairman Rinaldi was consistently rated among the top two most conservative members of the House by Rice University, Texans for Fiscal Responsibility, Young Conservatives, and Texas Eagle Forum. Rinaldi was, according to the Dallas Morning News, which is not a good thing to say. I mean, I've given that paper up so much. Anyway, but according to the Dallas Morning News, instrumental in strengthening the punishments in the sanctuary cities ban, and authored and passed into law measures that remove from office public officials who adopt sanctuary city policies, require government contractors and subcontractors to use E-Verify, revoke pensions of teachers convicted of committing sex crimes against students, allow churches to utilize volunteers to provide security services without risking heavy fines, and prohibit any taxpayer money from going to Planned Parenthood. He served as the pro-life whip for Texas Right to Life in 2017. So that's Chairman Rinaldi's background. Chairman Rinaldi earned his Juris Doctor with honors from Boston University School of Law and a Bachelor of Business Administration and Economics from James Madison University in Virginia, the Shenandoah Valley. Matt attends St. Anne's Catholic Parish in Capel with his wife, Corley, and his son, Rush. Let us give a hearty welcome to Chairman Rinaldi.
Thank you, I appreciate it.
Remember, we have asked for questions. I have 9. When Chairman Rinaldi is finished with his talk, I'm going to be asking those questions. They're good questions, probably if one has them in this room, maybe 100 have them, the same thing. So stay tuned. Thank you.
And if they're hard to answer, I'll just artfully dodge them. Now, thank you for having me here today. I want to talk a little bit about, just going back to what we're doing as the Republican Party of Texas to help you in the grassroots. What that looked like last November heading into this legislative session and what we did in the election, and what we're doing now in order to turn all of those electoral victories into policy victories that affect your lives. Again, so we can win elections in the future and start the cycle again. Our goal is to make Republicans in this state as strong as possible. I do want to talk about what we do, because it was always, you assume that people know what you do, but I remember one of the first days when I was a state rep, you know, you're thinking you're very important, you're legislating, and everyone realizes that. One of the first calls we got in our office was a lady from my district who said, "There's a bobcat on my porch, can you come and get it?" And I was like, I said, "Have you called animal control?" And she goes, "Oh no, they're so busy." All right. So I was talking to Abraham too, because he gets some of the same misconceptions, some of the emails we get as chair are like people tattling on each other, like in state committees. You'd be surprised at some of these things, like, can you remove my chairman from office because he didn't put this thing that he talked about on the agenda? And I get like a couple of those a day, and it was interesting. So today I got one, and I was thinking about it when I was up here, where they said, Martha, I forgot her last name, was a precinct chair in my county party. She was very rude to me at the meeting. Can you have her removed? So here's the deal. Can I have your precinct chairs removed because they were rude to you? No, I cannot. Do I care? Also, no. But I'm here to help on other things. So just to do a little recap, as Republicans, we have a lot to be proud of. I know a lot of you guys came after the 2022 elections and felt a little down because we didn't take the Senate. We didn't get those huge victories in the House. There were so many states where we did poorly or not as well as expected. But the good news is Texas was not one of those states. We did very well in the state of Texas. In fact, Texas is more red now than it was 4 years ago. So we saw, just to give you an example, 4 years ago, we had very close elections, low single digits for most of the big statewide offices. The governor did very well. But Dan Patrick won lieutenant governor by 5% of the vote. Ted Cruz won by 2% of the vote. I believe Ken Paxton won by 3% of the vote. Very close elections. We were very worried that if the trend lines continued, as we went from 2014 huge victory, and then it got closer and closer, that we possibly would be blue or purple this election. We haven't lost a statewide office since 1994. A lot of people were afraid this would be one of the first years that we would. And some of the early polling and even late polling showed again that same like mid-single digits. So the expectations, everybody rolled into the election a little nervous, but we worked. And we put together a great grassroots team who was driven. And to
together with our county parties, with our grassroots, with our office holders, and candidates on the ballot, put together a sweeping victory where every statewide official won by double digits, some by 15%. And we did that with increasing our numbers in the Senate, increasing our numbers in the House. Now, we saw some other states like Arizona, many disappointments. We saw like Pennsylvania, many disappointments. I want to talk a little bit about what caused that and why we didn't have that here. We heard a lot of talk about, from the press, about, I guess, wishful thinking. They wished the cause were what reinforced their own belief system. So they always talk about the Dobbs decision, right? I'm sure you've heard about, well, abortion. Abortion caused the closeness of the election. Abortion didn't cause the closeness of the election. Every single state that had a trigger law that outlawed abortion as a result of Dobbs, Republicans did very well. We did well. If you talk about Ohio, they passed a heartbeat bill, and then Mike DeWine won by 20 points. So if abortion was the issue, wouldn't the states that changed their abortion laws as a result of the decision have fared worse for Republicans? Yeah, well, they didn't. We did better in those states. We did better in the states that banned abortion or passed strict abortion. So what was it? I mean, I think we saw in several states, Republicans were falling behind on small donations. I think that was a huge factor. And that even happened here. Democrats outraised us in small donations. And a lot of that has to do with the platforms on which we're getting small donations. We're currently, the RNC is currently suing Google because we found that the last 5 days of every month, those solicitations for small donations were going to your junk mailbox. But the Democrat ones weren't. Again, fighting an uphill battle against institutions. And that's something we got to deal with. And we're currently trying to go to the courts to do that. We had other issues where Republicans weren't trying to play the election game better under the rules that were set. I'll give you an example. Like in Arizona, there's a big distrust of early voting. And I get why people have a distrust of voting machines and early voting and everything. But if you don't play to get your people out as early as possible and you're spending more money getting your people out later, there's a better chance that a lot of the people, something will come up. Maybe they get sick. Maybe a family member gets sick. Maybe something happens. And they don't vote. And your numbers go down. Also, when Democrats are trying to scheme ways to steal an election, is it a lot easier when they know what day all your people are coming out? We saw that in Arizona. We saw that in Arizona when on election day, Republicans were getting about 75% of the vote in a 50-50 state. So what did they do? All the machines that went down on election day. The paper ballots that weren't delivered to locations weren't delivered on election day. The voter suppression efforts happened on election day because they knew Republicans would come out. Here in Texas, we didn't do that. We sent out hundreds of thousands of mail-in ballot applications from the Republican Party of Texas to known Republicans so that people over the age of 65 could mail in their ballots early. And then we could take them off the list and spend the money getting the other people out. And because of that, I should say also we wanted to get people out as early as possible. Because of that, here in Texas, where in other states Republicans were getting killed in early voting and mail-in ballots, we won early voting and mail-in ballots in every statewide race in the state of Texas. So I always say, I want one day voting, paper ballots, absentee voting only upon cause, right? Hand counts. However, until we get there, I'm going to take the rules in place and I want to do it better than the Democrats do. And here in Texas, vote harvesting is illegal. So we don't do that here because it's illegal. In other states, it's not. And there were a couple states where there was a contrast that showed what happens when Republicans play by the Democrat rules and get better at it. So like in California, voter harvesting is legal. Vote harvesting is legal. Republicans in about 4 congressional districts in Southern California decided to ballot harvest. They would go to churches, Republican areas, collect ballots.
hand them in. Because of that, we picked up seats in California in Congress that we didn't expect to pick up. Now, Nevada, we lost a really big Senate seat by about 10,000 votes. Ballot harvesting is legal in Nevada, but there was no effort to do it by Republicans. Think about it. 10,000 votes, 10 churches. That's all you need. Ballot harvest for 10 churches, we pick up an extra Senate seat. Again, play by the Democrats' rules when they're in place and get so good at it that Democrats want to change it to one-man voting. Also, lastly, I think very importantly, we need a positive message. And here in Texas, we did that. We campaigned on legislative priorities that you chose at our state convention. We had a positive message on what we would do if we got elected. And I think we brought that to people so that they identified, we elect Republicans, they are going to do this. And I think where we did that, we did well. Because Texas did well. What was one other state that did well? Florida, right? Yeah. Won by 20 points in Florida, statewide. About, like, you know, some did better than others, but it's about a 20-point margin for Republicans in Florida. And everybody in Florida knew. Republicans changed their life in Florida. Why? Because during COVID, they could leave their house, they could go to church, they could send their kids to school. And in other states, they couldn't do that. The government locked them in their homes, quite literally. So Republican governance touched every life in the state of Florida. And they didn't only stop there. They attacked diversity, equity, and inclusion in their universities. They attacked corporate wokeism that infected every institution in the state. And they played to win in all of those areas. So I think we did that in Texas to an extent. I don't think we were as bold over the past couple of years as Florida. I think we saw that in election results. But what did that turn into in Florida, right? 20% win statewide. And when you look at the governor's race, for example, Ron DeSantis won by 0.4% 4 years earlier. He won by 20% 4 years later. We had, he won all counties in Florida except 5. And won every urban area except 2. So what did that look like? Dallas County is probably 20 to 25% Democrat advantage right now. You think it's unattainable, right? In Florida, Miami-Dade County was a 30% win for Hillary Clinton in 2016. Ron DeSantis lost Miami-Dade County by 20% in 2018. He won it by 11 points, double digits, this election. It's a 41% split. Imagine Dallas County going for the Republican by 11 points. That's what happened there. And it didn't happen by sacrificing our principles. It happened by being bold with our principles and playing to win in everything we did there. So I think that's our lesson. I mean, we need to be relentless in elections, playing by the rules, but getting every ballot we can under the rules that are in place while we're working to change those rules to be more fair. And then we need to implement policy once we're elected that gets people to vote for us. So that's what I've been focused on as chair here in Texas. Again, we had a robust get out the vote effort. We sent out mail-in ballots to hundreds of thousands of people who were eligible and we knew were Republicans. We had we spent about $9 million on the election and get out the vote and direct mail advocacy. Text messaging to try to get every voter out we possibly could. And we did it well, so that Texas wasn't one of those disappointing spots. Now, as we rolled into the legislative session, we have groups in RPT that were designed to turn those electoral victories into policy victories for us, so that we can show results. Actually, before I do that, let me talk about one thing that was very important that we did as a party that we never did before, and that's election integrity. Election integrity, obviously, is so important. If we don't play by fair elections, it's just not important, right? We can't just be advocacy and get out Republicans to vote and cheer for Republicans, rah-rah. It needs to be getting people out at the polling locations to make sure that those elections are conducted fairly. So what we did was, ahead of time, we never did this before as a state party, I had raised $1.2 million, I think was the final tally, for election integrity alone. This is just dedicated money for election integrity, which we would use to recruit people for the polls, for county parties who request it. We recruit people, train them, train poll watchers, and place them at polls. We had more poll watchers than we'd ever seen in so many different counties. In Dallas County, we had about 400, I think we had every polling location covered. There were probably 450 polling locations. 2 years earlier, we had 10 covered, just to give you an idea of the difference. Here in Collin County, our Dallas County hire also helped as well in recruiting poll watchers and training poll watchers here. And we did it as well in San Antonio, Houston. I was in Dallas County for Election Day. And let me tell you, when you have people everywhere, you hear of everything immediately and you can fix it. Your eyes on the ground. And when there was a problem with the e-polling machines in Dallas, we knew about it immediately, and we got reports from about 60 or 70 different locations that were consistent. So important. I mean, it was to the point where we looked at Central County. There was a bunch of people in the room with vests on, and I asked the county party worker, you know, how many of those people are ours? There are about like 25 people on the screen. And he goes, do you see that lady right there? I'm like, yeah. He goes, that's the only one that isn't ours. So that's another thing we've been doing. It was tremendously successful because the donors that donated to us also donated to the RNC effort 2 years earlier, didn't see the results from it. Ours was very apparent. We could point to the results, we could show the results, and we're gonna do it again. So I just wanted to mention that as well, because you know, John Beckmeyer, who's the executive director for our party, headed that effort, did such a tremendous job with it, and kudos to him for perfect implementation on that. We then rolled into legislative session, and the first issue we wanted to tackle, which I think was very important, was Texas is the only state in the country that has a legislative chamber that when the Republican Party wins a majority of seats, they willingly cede their power to Democrat chairman. This is the most absurd thing I'd ever seen, because then the Democrat chairman used that power against Republicans in ways that are just shocking. For example, one committee chair, Democrat committee chair, immediately implemented a speech code in her committee where a Republican couldn't say the word illegal immigrant because it was offensive. I say illegal alien. He even used the toned down word and got chastised for it and censored. We see Democrats roll out on the floor, accuse Republicans of being racist, of being sexist, and then they appoint them to committee chair positions. Why are we giving them megaphones for them to denigrate our own officials and our ideas and us personally? We had a president pro tem who is now a committee chair in the state house that effectively called Ted Cruz, a majority of our congressional delegation, seditionists. They said that they were directly responsible for the murder of 21 people in El Paso in that Walmart, simply because they advocated for strong border policy. So I'm sure a lot of you are directly responsible, he would say, for that as well. And he's appointed to a position of power. He's given a platform by Republicans whose voters elected them to implement our policies. It's absurd. It needs to stop. And we're going to keep advocating against that for as long as it takes so that Republicans, when we're elected, control the legislature. And I have to thank you. Now, even though we didn't do it this time, we made some progress. We went from 14 Democrat chairs out of 34, I think it was, to 8 or 9 out of 34. So it was cut significantly because you guys made a difference. The pressure you put on forced them to cut back and make a difference. Let's not stop until they're all gone. Let me say, after that, you know, after the Democrat chair's push, the legislature went into full swing. And I got to say, your Texas Senate was absolutely fantastic. Who's your senator, Angela Paxton?
Yeah.
Give her a huge thumbs up. Texas Senate were absolute rock stars, okay? And if anyone ever says, when you're talking to one of your elected officials, and they say, you grassroots people, you're never happy, right? All you guys do is complain, you're never happy. Nothing we can do can make you happy. This is what you say. You'd say, the Texas Senate this year, that's what makes me happy. Do that. Do exactly what they're doing. They set out a bold, bold agenda with priority bills that stood in stark contrast to what the Texas House was doing. Now, where are we right now where that's required? Like, why? Why would we want such boldness? I mean, I think it's obvious because the policies are better. But I jotted down a little bit some things I saw on the internet, right? Coming from, you know, major news stories that shocked me, that made me think this is a different time. This is a time where we needed something more, right? I jotted down the Mackey prosecution. Did you hear about the gentleman who was put in jail for 10 years because he shared a meme on social media that just said something like, hey, if you're Democrat, the election's Wednesday. I think he said, if you're a Democrat, you could vote by text. Text your candidate to this number. But Democrats who said, if you're a Trump voter, vote on Wednesday, didn't get the same treatment. He got put in jail for 10 years for that, for just sharing a meme. We saw a pro-life leader in Pennsylvania get his house raided by the FBI, and he was dragged off in handcuffs in front of his kids in the early morning hours. We saw Donald Trump get indicted by the New York prosecutor after his house was raided by the FBI. We saw a gentleman who defended himself during the riots in Austin get prosecuted for murder, sentenced to, I think, a maximum of 25 years in jail. Governor Abbott says he's gonna pardon him. Thank God we have a Republican governor. And we saw in New York City the gentleman who saved a trainload of people from a crazed lunatic who was threatening them, now being prosecuted for manslaughter, right? And we saw it before. We saw during COVID, keeping you in your homes. We saw the George Floyd riots. The people who were rioting didn't get prosecuted. People who were there on January 6th, they did, right? We saw here in the Texas House, 4 years early. Do you remember the last day of session in 2017 when Democrats filled the chamber, disrupted the House of Representatives? Seems very insurrection-y to me. This happened again with the gender mutilation of children bill this session. And the DA there would not prosecute and just let the people go the next day, as January 6th people who did nothing in the Capitol and just strolled around are currently still in prison. We are at a crossroads right now where we're in danger because of what we believe. But we're being treated differently by the law because of what we believe. And the left is taking over every institution in our country. Unless we do something, we're gonna lose it. And not only that, our kids are going to grow up in a very dangerous America for our views. We can't piddle around and say, okay, well, we're going to pass a gender mutilation bill and, you know, maybe a Second Amendment bill and a pro-life bill, and then we'll call it a day. Now, we need to win and put up as many victories on the board as possible. And I think your Texas Senate came out with priorities that did that. There's 30 bills that the Texas Senate prioritized. It's things like the state budget, right? But some of these priorities are exactly what we need, that attack leftism in every institution, protect our elections, protect our children. Things like restoring voter fraud to a felony, which it was downgraded to a misdemeanor last session, right? Senate Bill 2, passed by the Senate, prioritized, still hasn't been passed out of the House. We have protecting the Texas grid. Again, we will not have Republicans run this state for much longer if the lights can't stay on. That's why it's so important to have more natural gas capacity. And when you think about it, it's kind of what protects everything else. Because as soon as the lights go off, there ain't gonna be no more Republicans in charge of the state of Texas. Well, the lieutenant governor prioritized natural gas production of electricity to provide enough electricity to ensure that we have the lights on in Texas for a long, long, long time to come. Still hasn't passed out of the House. We have SB 8, which was a school choice proposal. Finally, we'll give parents choice here in the state of Texas. Dedicated $800 million to school choice. Universal school choice, which means it applies to everybody. Now, $800 million is only enough for 50,000 kids. 50,000 kids at $8,000 each. That'll probably expand as the program gets going. The Texas House just announced a committee sub yesterday that cuts that to $200 million. Takes away universal school choice and only gives it to people in F-rated schools and special ed students. Currently still fighting over that. We have Senate Bill 12, which bans children's exposure to drag shows, passed the Senate, over in the House, still hasn't passed over the House. Senate Bill 15 protects women's sports, ensures women compete in women's activities in colleges. We did the same thing in grammar and high schools as well, last session. Passed the Senate, still hasn't passed the House. Banning critical race theory in higher education, passed the Senate, still hasn't passed the House. Banned diversity, equity, and inclusion policies in higher education. That bill passed the Senate, still hasn't passed the House. And by the way, DEI policies, huge issue right now. You think University of Texas or UNT being the issue. Now, you know what school had the largest diversity, equity, and inclusion department? A&M did, exactly. The House version is now moving through committee, but a committee substitute said, well, if there's a private grant, you could still have DEI programs. So you can only have DEI if someone pays you to do it. That doesn't make any sense and just undermines the whole bill. We have eliminating tenure at academic institutions. Passed the Senate, still hasn't passed the House. Removing district attorneys who refuse to follow Texas law. Very much hoping this passes both chambers. There's a bill in each chamber for it. We need to do something about rogue DAs. We're simply not doing enough. Where have people been sleeping these last 3 years where they don't think it's a priority to ban COVID mandates? The Texas Senate passed a bill that would prohibit any governmental institution, local or state, from mask mandates, vaccine mandates, or business closures due to COVID-19. And it still hasn't passed the House. In fact, the only issues I think that the House took a lead on have been border issues. There's an HB 20 bill that was an absolutely fantastic border bill that was in the House. And then the speaker called a point of order and killed it. So we now amended a very bad version of HB 20 onto House Bill 7. And what it says in this version is the only way that the governor can police the border is if he gets permission from the local officials on the border who are Democrats. So it actually makes it worse. Now, I'm very confident that the Senate's going to fix it in committee, but we have to watch it. This is a problem. We have two houses of the legislature. We've had two houses of the legislature for 20 years, and we can't pass bills like this at the most dangerous time in our country's history. I know a lot of House members disagree with it, even if they won't be vocal about it because they don't want to go against House leadership. But please, call them. Ask them to move these bills. And I want to point to one last thing. Is there a bunch of election bills like restoring voter fraud to a penalty to a felony? Please call your legislator and tell them to ask the Elections Committee to move these bills. They shut down the Elections Committee in the House last week and said they weren't holding any meetings, and they're not going to hold any meetings this week, and all of the Senate election bills are tied up. So we will help you advocate, okay, as a party, but I need your help. Call your legislators, tell them to move these bills, and call Angela and thank her. Because truly, the Senate has just done a magnificent job. We need to put victories on the board so we can show people that we can change their lives with legislation, that we can protect Americans, that we can protect America, and we can save America for our kids so that they can enjoy all the things that we enjoyed growing up as well. So thank you. I'd love to get questions.
Probably. Yes, we have 9 questions. A few of them refer to some of the bills that you may have mentioned, but I'll ask the questions respecting the people that sent them. The first one is integrity. What are the Republicans doing? What are the Republicans going to do in the next election to prevent or adapt to the dirty tricks that Democrats use on election day? Previous speakers have talked about the use of those in the 2022 election, but have not indicated what we will do to offset the impact of those. Also, since the Democrats are innovative, if nothing else, what additional tricks do you see them employing in 2024?
You know, it is almost like playing whack-a-mole, right? When you solve one problem, they figure out another way around it. It's almost like, you know, software encryption, right? And dealing with hackers. We need to be dedicated to free and fair elections. And what we're doing as a party is we're texting people in districts, telling them to communicate to their reps when the bills aren't moving. We're informing people so that they can be better advocates. I mean, and we are texting, we're running TV ads in some districts, telling them, advocating for particular pieces of legislation. We're running direct mail in some districts on certain things. And some of you guys may have gotten something against casino gambling that was sent out by the party. So that's what we're doing. And none of this has ever been done on this scale by the party before. It's really a new thing. And we're seeing some results from it because we're seeing some movement after these communications go out.
This question has to do with the priorities, the legislative priorities for the 87th legislative session.
88.
They list them that were adopted in the state convention: election integrity, religious freedom, children and gender modification, abolition of abortion, constitutional carry, monument protection, school choice for all, ban taxpayer-funded lobbying. The legislative priorities identified a total of 76 bills in the 87th legislative session that addressed the RPT's top priorities. According to this committee's assessment report, 10 bills became laws when this was written. While the one bill resulted in a constitutional amendment, this roughly equates to a success rate of 14.5%. In baseball, a batting average of 145. Means you better find another sport. Only 5 of 8 priorities were influenced by the 87th legislative session. Republicans have had the majority in both legislative chambers since 2002. According to my math.
Is there a question?
Yes, that's 27 years. Question 1, how does the RPT intend to achieve a batting average of 1,000?
I just told you about some of the ways that RPT is trying to achieve a batting average of 1,000. We're being very aggressive in going to districts where before it was just email communications to the core and the grassroots. To be honest, if you go to the speaker's district right now, between us and other advocacy organizations, I think one out of every two ads on Fox News right now is talking about House bills that haven't been passed. And that's something we've never done, and we're seeing results from it. I disagree with the percentage on the previous session. The previous session, I think you're probably 4 out of 8, and you hit the two biggest things, right? And keep in mind, this is before most of the corporate wokeism and everything has just infected everything. But we passed constitutional carry. We banned abortion in Texas. How can you not be happy with banning abortion in the state of Texas? I never thought we'd see that in America. And then you also passed the election integrity bill, which had one bad portion, which is trying to be fixed now, but overall did provide us tools that we were able to better police this election than the last election. So I do think it was one of the best sessions we've had in terms of conservative priorities. Of course, you know, that's compared to previous ones, so I do want to bat 1,000. However, that was still good, and we hit the top two highest ones. This session can go either way. We're at a crossroads, right? There's a bunch of stuff that the Senate passed that's stuck in the House. It can either die or it can move still. We will find out over the next week or so. We got 16 days left in session. We'll see whether it's a good one or a bad one.
This is part of the same question, but a little different. What measures are being implemented to uproot the Democrats in Austin who have infiltrated the Republican Party and unabashedly promote the platform of the Democrat Party, and then in parentheses, these are the rhinos. So what can you say about that?
You're doing witch trials, just the whole nine yards. No, listen, you guys can, we're just trying to provide accurate information on what's happening to these bills, and you can decide who's acting like a Republican, who's not. We're just trying to provide you as much accurate information as possible, because with transparency, I mean, that's how you do it.
Okay. What are the pros and cons of passing HB 1635, which would prohibit political parties from denying an otherwise eligible candidate for office from running on their ballot?
Which one's 1635?
Yeah, 1635.
Which we're talking about. Okay, so fun fact, right? I told you of all the bills dying in the House and they shut down the elections committee. They didn't pass any of the Senate election bills that were placed over. However, they did find time to pass 3 bills to directly attack the Republican Party. This is one of them. And it basically denies over $1 million in primary funds if the Republican Party denies ballot access to somebody for a reason that is determined not to be valid under state or federal law. So what we do is we get a bunch of applications, we deny ones that are late, or if somebody's a non-judge, runs for judge, we'll look up their bar status, we'll deny it. Sometimes they'll sue and challenge the reason. And then a court will come in and issue what's called a mandamus and tell us we either did it right or wrong, or they'll deny a mandamus, say we did it right. They'll issue a mandamus, say, no, you should have accepted this one. That's the way the process works now. What they want to do is make this completely, like, disproportionate penalty if you deny an application that they think should not be denied. Just a complete attack on the party, and it's designed so that if you guys get the funny idea that once you censure somebody, you should be able to say who should be a Republican, who shouldn't be a Republican on the ballot, that they can take away all your money. That's what it's for. So it also just practically creates chaos, because if I'm telling Abraham that if he accepts a ballot application that's late, or if a non-lawyer runs for judge and there's no punishment if he accepts it, but if he doesn't accept it, and he's found later to should have accepted it, they take away all his money to have a primary election. What do you think Abraham's going to do? He ain't going to check to see if a judge is a lawyer. He's going to accept everything. It would be complete chaos. It would bring chaos to the election. It would cost our candidates way too much money, because then they'll have to sue if anyone files late. Just a poor idea all around. By the way, there's another bill that they passed towards the end that, number one, says that advocacy for or against a speaker in a speaker's election is lobbying. So you have to register as a lobbyist. And two, and then secondly, advocacy for or against legislation is the same thing as advocacy for or against a candidate for purposes of Texas Ethics Commission reporting. So they don't like you guys advocating for or against legislation.
This question is pretty straightforward. What is the status of the bill banning the sterilization of children?
It's one of the good points, if you want to leave on a high note. We just, SB 14, which is the bill banning child gender mutilation, just passed the House with, a near super majority of votes. It was a bipartisan vote. Several Democrats voted with the Republicans. One Democrat even gave a very eloquent speech in favor of child gender modification. Huge victory in pushing back against the tide of this barbaric lunacy that's taken over our country.
These questions have to do with the current
97,
speaker.
Yeah, 97 votes, by the way, out of 150 for the bill.
Concerning the speaker, Dade Phelan. How and why is he's calling him a rhino, Dade Phelan, Speaker of the House, and do you support him? And maybe you could comment on how we got there and anything you could share with us.
I don't know if I could say it. I might have to register as a lobbyist in the House bill next to the Senate.
Whatever you feel comfortable saying.
Listen, I think it's inconceivable that we allow Democrats to share as part of the leadership team in any legislative chamber nowadays. Dan Patrick got elected as, if you remember, like 10 years ago, the House used to be the more conservative chamber than the Senate. Then Dan Patrick came in and he changed one thing, which made a huge difference, is he stopped giving Democrats leadership positions. There's one left, right? And it's, he's chair of a public safety committee, and he is a former prosecutor who's fairly conservative on those issues. And the second thing he did was he's not bringing up bills unless a majority of Republicans support those bills. Amazing. You're running a chamber as a Republican in a partisan chamber in a partisan political system. Given the disparity between the parties now, it's inexcusable that you don't run a chamber that way. So I disagree highly with the shared leadership in the Texas House. I think if you change that, I think everything else falls into place.
I'm glad they changed.
There's another question regarding Dade Phelan, and it's what responsibility do you and the Texas Republican Party leadership take for the embarrassment that is Dade Phelan, our leader of the House, Texas House, who is totally ignoring the priorities put forth by the members of the party in convention?
I take no responsibility for that. Now, we're running, with Democrat chairs, we ran over $20,000 worth of radio ads in the Beaumont area. Talking about that issue. We're running television ads now on Fox News. I think we're doing about $25,000 to $50,000 worth of ads in the area, advocating for some of those bills that I was talking about to get through committee and get to the House floor. So right now, we're just advocating for issues and trying to move everything through despite that.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Chairman Rinaldi.
Thank you.
Okay, well, first of all, thank you for the insight and the upgrade in information that we've been able to get about Texas and what's going on in our state. So we have a certificate of appreciation for your attention here tonight and helping our people understand what's going on in the state.
Thank you.
And we have for you, sir, one of our famous coffee cups. These are special. They're only given out to certain people. So thank you very much.
It's the greatest thing in my life.
Thank you. I always tell the recipients that regardless of what coffee brew you put in here, it's going to be a lot stronger than anything you've ever had before.
I like it. Thank you so much for having me. I appreciate it.
So listen, we're going to wrap this up here real quick. I just got a couple things. First of all, see these little name badges? They got to be on the table before you leave. If not, we'll have to send the sheriff out to get you, okay? So really, if you do all the work that we have to go through to get these badges, get them sorted out and get them lined up, I think you would appreciate our position. Secondly, I had a question during intermission, and the question was, if I didn't vote in this last election, do I still have the right to vote in this new runoff? And the answer is absolutely. So please vote. We need every vote we can get. Whether you voted before or not, you have the right to vote, and we need you to exercise that right. With that, yes. Oh, yes. Thank you, Clayton. Clayton wanted to remind me that in the back at the where you registered, we have people sitting back there with the documents for you to fill out. If you want to come to our program on the Constitution that we talked about, bring you and your son or daughter or grandchild, let us know that. We have to have some idea about the size of the group that we have. Thank you, Clayton, for bringing that to my attention. I am anxious to end the meeting because one of the other things you've talked to us about, besides the quality of the meal, besides the improved speakers that we are providing. By the way, if you look on our website, you will see that we are booked solid for the rest of the year on speakers. And you all always say to us, please end these meetings by 8 o'clock. So it's 8:02. The meeting is adjourned. Thank you.
Good night.